Hi, welcome to Touch Talk, talking about consent, and specifically talking about consent with youth. So my name is Erica, and I'm a sexuality and reproductive health facilitator at SERC, the Sexuality Education Resource Centre here in Manitoba. We are a community-based nonprofit pro-choice organization that promotes sexual health through education. So this presentation was created in part for the SRH week, the Sexual and Reproductive Health Awareness Week, which is an annual campaign. But provincially, they also have a topic, and we chose the theme or the topic of sexual consent. So what my intent today is to give you a definition of consent, ways to talk to youth about consent, and also just a bit about the laws around consent as well. So today what I wanted to talk about is the definition of consent, talking about some of the laws around consent, and then giving some ideas of how we can present that information to youth. The first thing I always like to start with my consent presentations and sessions, is what is consent? So the definition of consent usually comes very easy for most folks when I ask them. They say things like it's an agreement, it's asking, it's getting permission, and all of those things are correct. I feel like what gets tricky for folks is when you add a context to sexual consent, then they trip up a little bit. So consent, very basically, is an expression of respect. So you want to be respected, you're respecting other people. And when you're talking to youth about consent, that's a really good place to start, just because people learn early on that respecting others is important, right? Respecting their space, respecting their ideas, their beliefs, and having your beliefs and your body and everything else respected as well. So respect is a very basic concept, and there's a primer for that already when they're children. So that's sort of where I like to start. Kind of continue on to what it means in a sexual context. So everybody's body belongs to them. You know, everybody has the right to make choices about their bodies. Consent is about choice. And it's the choice of who gets to touch your body, when they get to touch it, and how they get to touch it. So this is a good opportunity to talk about boundaries. What are your sexual likes? What are your sexual dislikes? What are you comfortable with? What aren't you comfortable with? It's communication. Consent is about communication and communicating with your partners, what you like, what you don't like, what you're comfortable with. And this is an ongoing process. This is, you know, talking before sexual activity, you know, as a primer, to see where one another is at. It's also a continued discussion during sexual activity. We don't see it very much in our culture, in media, or in movies, Hollywood, pornography. You don't see people talking during sex and making sure that their partners are feeling safe and good. But that is an important aspect of consent. It's talking during, you know, does this feel good? You know, where are you at? Can I do this? It's just kind of always having that communication going on, even during the sexual activity. And then also after sexual activity, a check-in sort of with your partner. You know, what was good? How are you feeling? You know, anything that they need to know, or, you know, ask them how they're feeling. So yeah, communication and consent go hand in hand. Very important that we keep those communication lines open, so that everybody is comfortable and feels safe and has the best sexual experience they can possibly have. So continuing with explaining consent, is everyone involved in the sexual activity needs to know what's going on and needs to agree with the activity. So this is anything from hugging and kissing to oral sex or even talking sexually to one another. You do need to make sure that the person understands what's happening and also agrees to every single sexual activity that's happening. So, knowing what's happening is that, you're clear of mind, you're sober, you're not under the influence of drugs or alcohol. You can't give consent if you're under the influence. So being sober is probably the most important thing and making sure that you are. But also when you're talking to youth, making sure that you're not sounding judgmental or shaming them if part of their lifestyle is drinking and doing drugs. Make sure that you're talking about safety. Make sure that they have a safety plan, or if they think something's going to happen because they're drinking or doing drugs, that they have friends that they can call if anything goes wrong. So you don't want to alienate the youth by saying, you can't give consent if you're drinking, and then end it that way. Realizing that the reality is that a lot of them might be using drugs or alcohol while engaging in sexual activity. So just being conscious of where your youth is coming from is important as well. So agree, part of that is, it's one thing to say yes and it's another thing to mean yes. So it should be a yes that's free of pressure. You're not feeling pressured to say yes in any way, or you're not feeling threatened in any way to say yes. So you're giving an enthusiastic yes, you want to do it, there's no pressure, there's no threat, and everyone involved really, really wants to engage in the sexual activity. So this is sort of where scenarios can play a good part in teaching about consent as well, right? So, what's a scenario with a threat, or what's a scenario with someone pressuring someone else, right? Create this sexual context so that the youth can know, realistically how it would happen.
Hi, I'm Bree Wallagroski. I'm a sexuality and reproductive health facilitator at SERC, and our topic today is how to talk to your kids about sex. So we often get a lot of emails and questions from parents at workshops about how do I talk to my kids about sex and sexuality. It's such an intimidating topic, but it doesn't need to be. And so we're here to give you some tips on how do you talk to your kids about the situation, whether you feel awkward or nervous. It's pretty normal to feel nervous. We don't really talk about healthy sexuality much in our society. But it's important to give our kids a healthy foundation for growing up and having good relationships with their bodies and good relationships with other people. So it's important to talk about. So the first thing we always say is to that you're doing great, to embrace the awkwardness that you feel when talking about sex and sexuality and topics of sexuality, that it's okay to feel uncomfortable, and just to keep pushing through and trying. And if you mess up today, you can just try again tomorrow. And we guarantee that the more that you try to talk about it, the easier it'll be. And the more you normalize talking about sex and sexuality, the better it'll be, and the easier it'll be. We also say that the best time to start talking about sexuality is when children are really young. So if you wait until you're like the kid's 16 or 17 to start talking to them about sex, it might be hard to start introducing that topic at that time. It might be really confusing and intimidating. So it's best to start off for any age of your kids, no matter what age they are. You can always talk about topics about sexuality, such as privacy, consent, what healthy relationships look like, what bodies look like, all those things. And that you can do at any age. And then that opens the door to good conversations in the future. So if you're really stuck, a good place to start to talk to your kids about sexuality is the issue of consent. So consent means that everyone's body belongs to them, and that means that they are allowed to decide who's allowed to touch them and when they can touch them and how they can touch them. So that decision's up to the person who's being touched. And so when you talk with kids about consent, what we're really talking about is people's bodies and people's relationships and how those two things interact. And so maybe that's a little less intimidating than saying sex or sexuality, but that's the core of what we're talking about, is how we interact within our relationships. And for kids, it's really important to teach and start talking to them about how different types of touching is appropriate in different types of relationships. So with families, you often have intimate touching like hugs and cuddling. With close friends, you have different types of touching, like maybe hugging or standing close. And then with strangers, there's usually no touching is acceptable, right? So different types of relationships lead to different types of appropriate touching. And it's important for kids to know the differences between those different types of relationships and to know what a healthy relationship looks like and what consent looks like. So there's 3 points that we talk to parents about talking to their kids. The first one is that everyone has a body and everyone's body is important. The second one is that everyone gets to decide about their body, who gets to touch them. And the third is that touches should never hurt or feel bad. So we're just gonna go through all those points for you. So number one, everyone has a body and everyone's body is important. So it's really helpful for kids to understand that their body and their feelings are really, really valuable and really important. And how they feel about touching matters. And matters to them and matters to other people too. We also want them to know that other people have bodies which also have different sorts of feelings and different sorts of needs and boundaries. So to understand that their needs about touching and their needs of their friends about touching or other people in society, that everyone's different and everyone has different lines so that they can respect that everyone might have different ideas about what touching is and different feelings about what touching means for their body. So if your kid wants to hug one of their friends and the friend doesn't really want to be hugged, it doesn't mean that they're not your friend. It doesn't mean that they're mad at you. It just might mean that other people have different ideas about what touching is for them, and some just don't like it, and that's okay. Everyone's okay. So the more we talk to our kids about that, that their body is really important, that the bodies of other people are really important, the healthier our society will be, we'll build a consent culture, and the better relationships your kids, a good foundation, you'll lay a good foundation for your kids to have good relationships in the future. So point number two is that everyone has a body and everyone's allowed to decide who gets to touch them. So as we talked about a little bit before about hugging, everyone has different ideas of what's a good touch for them, whether they want to be hugged. Some people and kids really love to be hugged, some people and kids really don't. And all of those things are okay. And again, to know the differences between the different relationships about what touch is appropriate and what touch is not. And so the more the kids know about their rights, that they don't need to be touched by people if that's not what they want, the more that they know about their own feelings, the more they know about their own boundaries, the more they know about the feelings and boundaries of others, they can better respond to the needs of other people's, and they can respect their own bodies, and they can respect the bodies of other people at the same time. And they can also start building the skills to know about what healthy relationships look like. And if a bad situation comes up or an unhealthy relationship comes up, that they know that this is something that isn't very good, and they can go get help from an adult or a parent or caregiver in those situations. So it protects them also. And point number three is that touching should never hurt and should never feel bad. So there are places on our body, which is our private areas, that people shouldn't be touching casually. So kids should know that those spaces are off limits. But we need to always remember that bad touching isn't just physical touching, it can be emotional touching too. So any touching that gives you a bad feeling is not a good touch. So say if my mom touches my shoulder and my arm and I'm totally okay with that, that's great. But if a stranger would do the same thing to my arm, that would feel a little not okay, right? So it's the same touch, but in one case it's okay, in one case it's not okay. And it's really important for kids to know the differences between those things to keep them safe, and to give them the skills to identify what a good, healthy situation is for them and what a bad situation is, and how to respond to those things. So we really want kids to know to protect themselves, to trust their guts and trust their instincts, to be able to have the agency about their body to say who's allowed to touch them and who's not, and to respond if something is happening that they're not really aware of. So we're giving kids the skills and the tools to protect themselves and to know how to respect other people as well. So all of these principles of consent and these principles of healthy sexuality will really build a really good foundation for your kids to live lives of healthy relationships where their bodies are respected and the bodies of others are respected. We're really going to build a consent culture together where everyone's feelings matter, everyone's bodies matter, and where bodies are celebrated and consent is part of our everyday activities. And our everyday understandings of how we relate to each other. And hopefully these conversations will lead to different conversations of different topics of sexuality, like some of the ones that I mentioned before, privacy, bodies, and also some of the bigger ones, STI transmission, pregnancy, all of those things. And so hopefully that'll open the door for you to start talking about some of the bigger issues. And if you need any help with that, we'd love to help. You can give us a call or check out our website at www.serc.mb.ca. We have some resources for you and would love to talk to you.
So I also like to just briefly touch on the law. It's one thing to say, you know, consent is respect and we should be doing it regardless, but in the eyes of the law as well, sex without consent isn't sex, it's sexual assault in fact. So sexual assault or rape is punishable by law. I feel that's important also to mention that there are consequences to not getting consent and engaging in sexual activity. But this is also a good time to talk about our society and how that really does play out in court sometimes, right? So there are consequences to those actions, but what's the context of our culture? We don't live in a consent culture right now. There's a lot of blame for sexual assault survivors, right? There's a lot going against people who have been assaulted, from blaming them, you know, from anything from what they were wearing to what they said, to what they didn't say, they didn't do. So don't shy away from talking about the greater context of our culture and how that can affect how people feel when they're assaulted or if they're going to go to the law about an assault. Have those conversations. I think that's a realistic thing to bring up and it's important to talk about. So another thing I like to discuss is the age of consent laws. I don't spend too much time talking about this in particular, but one thing I do like to point out is once you're 16, you can make decisions about who you want to have sex with. Doesn't matter their age, it's, you know, regardless of age, you do have that choice. However, I like to stress the exception to that rule, which is if you're between 16 and 18, you can have sex with who you'd like, as long as they're not someone who has authority over you. So we're talking about a teacher or a coach, a leader in the community, anybody who has that authority over you. And then we talk a little bit about why that is, right? So if it's a teacher or a coach, that person has power over you and they can use that power to you know, take advantage of you sexually or pressure you or threaten you, right? So it's a law that's meant to protect folks who are between 16 and 18. And knowing those exceptions, I think, is really important so that people don't get in trouble in those situations. I also like to point out the culture of texting or sexting, as you call it, and consent as well. So this is when people send sex-related texts to one another or use any social media platform to send each other sexual words or pictures or videos, and how consent fits into that as well. So the principles apply to online stuff, not just in person. So the person sending the text or the sext should make sure that the content is legal, the content should be consensual, and that the receiver also gives consent. So what do I mean by the content being legal? Well, if you're under 18, you cannot send texts or sexts, like pictures of people who are under 18. Those are considered child pornography in the eyes of the law. So just being careful with the content being legal, that if the photos or videos are of anyone who is under that age, that it is considered criminal. The content needs to be consensual. So does the person depicted in the text or in the video know that this picture or video is being shared with others? You do need that person's consent. And then the receiver needs to consent as well. So just sending an unsolicited video or nude photo is problematic. It's not consensual. It's sexual harassment. So there are levels of getting consent in those situations as well. So this is also a good time to talk about being more than a bystander for youth as well, right? So if you receive a text from a friend and you're not sure if that photo that you received, the person gave consent to that, you know, talk to the person who sent that. Tell them, you know, if you didn't get consent, this is sexual harassment. You know, just being that person where you're calling people out if they are sending pictures that are non-consensual, so that we can stop that from happening. If we're silent on these things, then it really doesn't change the culture, right? So yeah, talk to the youth about maybe talking to the person who's been sharing those things and putting an end to it. It's really important in that way. Hi, let's talk about how to put on a condom. So there are a few steps to putting on a condom. The first one, very important, is that you want to get consent from your partner. So consent means that everyone involved in the sexual activity knows and agrees to this activity. The next thing you want to do is get yourself some condoms and check to see if the expiry date is good. If it's expired, you're going to want to toss it. If it's not, then it's good to go. So this one's good, 2021, we're good to go. The next step that you want to do is you want to make sure that there's no punctures, no holes in the package. The way that you can do that is just squeeze it a bit. If there's air in it, it's good. If there isn't, there probably is a hole or it was damaged in some way, and you're going to want to toss that and start over again with a new condom. Once you have squeezed it, now you're ready to open it. There is a tab to help you with that, so you don't need to use your teeth or a knife or anything sharp like scissors, just because you don't want to rip the condom inside as well. So easy enough to just tear it open carefully so that you're not dropping it either, taking the condom out this way. Now that you've got the condom, this one is lubricated on both sides. If you wanted to add more lube, you could on the inside or the outside, but these ones come with lube on them already. Now you want to make sure that it's going to be on the right side so that you're rolling it down and not on the other side. And what I like to do to check that, you can kind of see it in the crease there, but I like to just blow in it to be sure. And now that I know what side is which, I'm going to take the tip of it, I'm going to squeeze it with at least two fingers, place it on the woody and roll it down. You want to make sure you're rolling it down all the way to the base so that it doesn't come off accidentally during your sexual activity. You're going to want to use it, enjoy your consensual sex with your partner, and once you're done, you want to make sure that you're holding the rim, pulling away from your partner, taking the condom off carefully so there's no spillage, again, away from your partner. And then once you have it off, you can take it, put a little knot in it, and then discard it. You never want to use a condom more than once. They are not reusable, and also just use one condom at a time. So the reason is that if you use more than one, the friction of both those condoms could actually rip the condoms, defeating the purpose of using one in the first place. So those are your steps. You're going to want to check the expiry date, squeeze it to see if there's air in it, no holes, open it carefully, squeeze the tip, or sorry, make sure that it's on the right side so that it can roll down. Then you're going to want to squeeze the tip, roll it down all the way to the base, use it, take it off carefully away from your partner, tie it up, dispose of it. So that's how you put on a condom. I always like to remind the youth as well that sexting is not necessarily a bad thing, right? Again, it's not shaming them if they're going to be doing that. That could be a very healthy and natural part of someone's sexuality, the way that they want to do things sexually. But it is risky, right? When I ask the youth, you know, if you put out a picture into the social media platforms, is it ever really private? And every single one of them always knows that it's not necessarily private, that once it's out there, it's out there. It's not really yours anymore, and you lose control over that. So it is a risky activity, just keeping that in mind, but also realizing that it may happen in youth's lives and in adult lives as well. So some of the ways that we at SERC talk about consent with youth is through activities and games. We do scripting and role play. So scripting is important in the way that it allows the youth to use their own words, play out scenarios that maybe might happen in their lives. Role play, how would they phrase consent, or how would they ask for consent? What would they do in a situation where someone didn't give consent? So it's just a way of getting them to use their own words if they're uncomfortable with using consent, or like, can I get consent? Is how would you ask for consent? So that's an important way sort of to talk to youth about consent. Examples and scenarios are really, really good too. We have certain scenarios, again, creating context in a sexual context. So, there are two people, they're dating. One of them, says, if you don't have sex with me, that means you don't love me. Or if you don't have sex with me, I'll break up with you. Can the other person give consent in this situation? And then having that discussion. So giving them the scenario where it gives a little bit of context of where people are coming from, and then what they would do. And discussing that is really important as well. And then I always do like to throw in some of the law stuff as well. So again, to recap, good ways are activities and games, scripting or role play, examples, scenarios, and also just talking a little bit about the laws and how they apply as well. So if you are interested in knowing more about the activities and the games that we use with our youth, you can contact SERC. You can give us a call or email us or even visit our website. But that's all I have for you today about consent. I hope it's helped you. And hopefully it helps you talk to any youth that you work with. And thanks so much for listening.